honourable Prime Minister, honourable Prime Ministers, Ministers, and President of the Asian Infrastructure Development Investment Bank, Mr. G. Likin, friends, and distinguished delegates from various parts of the world, excellencies, ladies and gentlemen, it is my honor to have been invited to speak in this eminent gathering dominated by a galaxy of eminent personalities. I particularly take this opportunity to welcome the president of our new development partner, Asian Infrastructure Investment Bank, Mr. Jin Lipin, who is an old friend of mine from our early days as Howard Humphrey Fellows. He is stint in the World Bank as Executive Director, Vice President of the Asian Development Bank, and subsequently the President of Asian Infrastructure Investment Bank. And it is a new development partner, as we are all aware. Nepal is one of the founding members of the organization. And under the dynamic and extremely able leadership of Jin Lipin, Asian Infrastructure Bank is doing a tremendous job, has taken off with a good start. We look forward to working with his organization for the development of infrastructure in our country. I have been particularly asked by the hosts to speak on the economic reforms Nepal has introduced, and particularly because of my association with the reform process, to promote investment promotion. Nepal's economic liberalization followed political liberalization, especially after the political change of 1990, when we had liberal democracy and the first elected government was in place. We started liberalizing our economy to promote more investment, to open space for all sectors practically, private sector, private investment, local and foreign, social sector, non-governmental organizations, cooperatives, community organizations. So for the mammoth task of development, which is a total operation, not operation of a single organization, we need space, we need to encourage all sectors of the society, public, private, community, and cooperatives, and whatnot, everything. Before the initiation of these reforms, Nepal had a very restrictive policy to private investment, whether in industry, services sector, trade, everywhere. It was restrictive policy regime, was restrictive to private investment and foreign investment. Industrial sector was dominated by a plethora of regulations, licensing regime, and all that. Trade control, especially external trade control, through tariff walls, through licensing system, and through import licensing system, and all types of restrictions were there. And there was dual exchange rate as far as foreign exchange rate was concerned. People, entrepreneurs, exporters, which earned foreign exchange, had to surrender their foreign income, foreign exchange to the central bank at a price much lower than the market price. Infrastructure sector, like power generation, like airlines, like telecommunication, were off limits to the private sector. It was the sole monopoly of the government. Similarly, banking sector, financial sector, insurance sector, more than 90% was government-owned. There was restriction on private entry. So practically everything was government-controlled. It restricted the entry of private sector. It restricted the entry of foreign investment. So development was constrained. Economic opportunities were constrained. So the new government, after the political change in 1990, initiated a series of reforms, plethora of reforms, sweeping changes to give space to, as I said, practically every section of the society. We brought in new Industrial Enterprise Act to pave the way for the licensing of private investment, particularly in the industrial sector, except for those industries which were in the negative list. We brought in new Foreign Investment and Technology Transfer Act to pave the way for 100% foreign equity in industries. Similarly, we brought sweeping changes in the trade regime. Now, previous quantitative restriction and licensing system in foreign trade was, in import was dismantled, and everything was possible to be imported under open generalized licensing, except for those products which were in the negative list. And we introduced partial convertibility in foreign exchange, making it possible, it fully convertible in all current accounts. So there was incentive to our more foreign currency. Similarly, we opened space for private sector in the banking, insurance, and other financial sector, which brought in quite a large number of new banks, financial institutions, insurance companies. Not just that, private airlines were open. We introduced open air policy. We also brought in private sector, foreign investment, telecommunication sector. Similarly, now even energy production, power production was possible, now was made possible for the private sector. I'm sorry, it's not very bad throat, so I'm sorry. So all these sweeping changes, not just that, reforms were introduced in the revenue system, in the taxation system. New tax system, value-added taxes, was brought in. It's a modern scientific tax system. Income tax was made compatible with modern standards. It was modernized. Similarly, reforms were introduced in all the systems also. The whole public expenditure pattern was reviewed. Face review was made of public expenditure. And there was more concentration to the social sector now, to poverty elevation, to rural development, to health, education. There was pronounced emphasis on the social sector. So this was a new change brought in. Decentralization Act was introduced to give more power to the local bodies. As a result of this, what was the outcome? What was the result? The growth rate in the 90s reached at some years up to 7%. This is the record growth rate achieved in Nepal's history. So the 90s, early part of 90s, recorded high economic growth. Export sector boomed, and export sector, export earnings, finance as much as more than 50% of our import bill. Now it is less than 10%. Export-import ratio is less than 10% at the moment. It is a dismal figure. But in the late 90s, our export earnings covered more than 50% of our import rate. Similarly, new multinational corporations entered the country and everything was booming. Financial sector expanded, economic activities expanded, airlines, telecommunications, similarly private investment in hydropower expanded. But the latter part of the 90s, now political instability started. The whole decade after that was dominated by political turmoil, turbulence, insurgency, conflict, political instability. That reduced our growth prospects. So we could not sustain the high growth rate achieved in the 90s, in the subsequent decade. But even despite that, we made substantial achievements, substantial progress in a number of fields, particularly in the social sector. As the chairman was mentioning about progress in the social sector. Progress in social sector, Nepal's progress in social sector is rated as one of the best in the world. The Human Development Report published by the United Nations in 2010 categorized Nepal as one of the top three performers in social development. Average life of a Nepali increased by 15 years in 25 years. In 1990, the average Nepali lived 54 years. Now, average Nepali lives 71 years. This happened in a period of one generation, about 20 years. Maternal mortality rate declined by almost 75%. Infant mortality rate, child mortality rate declined by almost 75%. These are credible achievements. Similarly, in the hunger, global hunger index published by IFRI, was based in Washington, D.C., International Food Research Organization, Nepal's record, Nepal's status in matters of hunger as measured by stunted growth below 5 years and malnutrition, Nepal's status is the best in South Asia. We are left behind other South Asian countries in hunger. Similarly, other indicators, our poverty declined from about 50% of the population to now at the moment, the ratio is something like 21-22%. People living below poverty line declined from 50 years to 21-22 years. And our macro management, everybody speaks highly about macro management. Institutions like the World Bank, Asian Development Bank, IMF, and other development partners are appreciative of the sound and prudent fiscal management, macro management Nepal has done. Our dependence on foreign assistance has declined tremendously. In the early 90s, two-thirds of our development assistance, development budget, came from foreign sources. Now it is only one-third, two-thirds is financed internally. Our revenue situation improved tremendously because of the expansion of economic activities. Like our revenue GDP ratio, people are surprised, the highest in South Asia. Our revenue GDP ratio is about 20%, although it is not a highly taxed country. This is because of the expansion of economic activities, and partly I suspect it is because of the underestimation of our national accounts. So these were very credible achievements despite the period of long turbulence and turmoil. Now, after the end of conflict, and the beginning of peace process, normalization of the political situation, now we thought that a new generation of reforms is necessary. A new second generation reforms is necessary. Because one-time reform is not sufficient. You have to keep up with the changing times, changing situation, with the global trends. So in recent years, last 3 years or so, we introduced a series of new reforms. Special Economic Zone Act has been enacted. New labor law is now in the offing with the agreement of all the stakeholders. Similarly, new Industrial Enterprise Act, new Foreign Investment and Technology Act, about half a dozen acts with regard to in the field of finance and banking system to strengthen the regulatory and supervisory authority of the central bank. and to keep our financial sector complying with the international standards on money laundering, keeping up with the best practices prevalent globally, and countering terror financing. All these new laws and acts have been now introduced in operation, which makes our financial regulations, financial system in line, compatible with international norms, standards, and best practices. And more importantly, as you know, as a result of these reforms, we have more than 1 dozen private airlines in Nepal, dominating our skies. We have telecommunications, foreign investment in telecommunications system, which is already now bigger than our government telecommunications. Similarly, hydropower, more than 40% of the power generation is from private sector. So Nepal is open for more private investment, more foreign investment, practically in the energy sectors. Nepal has tremendous advantages, especially to those friends, prospective investors who are coming from other countries. I would like to highlight a few advantages that the country has. The country's human capital is our asset. Nepalese, wherever they have gone, have made their mark everywhere. We are hardworking people, very resilient people, and last 2-3 decades have seen tremendous asset in terms of human capital. Thousands of doctors and engineers are serving in various parts of the world. So this hard-working Nepalese, I think this is a low manpower cost, low human resource cost, low labor cost. This is one definite advantage. The other advantage is Nepal has one of the best climates in the world. The biodiversity of Nepal is second to none. Within a limited space of about 200 kilometers or so from northern Himalayas to the flatland, we have practically any type of agroclimatic zone imaginable. That makes possible to make this country a real agro power in high value products, high value agriculture products. So this is another asset we have. We have potential to be carbon free country because of the tremendous hydro potential, solar energy potential. We can make this country without much difficulty a country of clean energy, carbon free country. We don't have dirty coal. So in the world polluted by dirty coal energy, this country offers, you know, prospect for clean energy. I say clean energy powerhouse. So those industries which want to brand their products from the country of the Himalayas, from the country of the Lord Buddha, carbon-free product from clean energy, this would be a good brand name, good possibility. These are Nepal's possibilities. On the market side, Nepal may be a small market. Because of our national income population, it may be small. But we have preferential trading arrangement with a big country like India. Now we have SAFTA free trade in the SAARC region, huge population of the SAARC region, South Asia. This is our market. Goods may be produced in Nepal, but they can be marketed in South Asia. We have preferential trading arrangement with China also, another huge market, GSP facility from USA, and arms for everything facility from European Community. Because of our LDC status, because of our low income status, we have privileges of preferential trading arrangement with major markets in the world. I have been reminded of the time limitation. I don't want to take more of your time. Nepal is a country of great possibilities, tremendous possibilities. I hope in the coming days, the political instability we saw in the past will no longer be there. With guaranteed peace, with good policies and good things in thing I just wanted to mention. You know, we, after the hard work of several years, we have developed a model project development agreement, PDA. And that was the basis for, you know, negotiating the 900 megawatt Upper Karnali Hydro, 900 megawatt Arun 3 project. Similarly, our Upper Trishuli project. So with Indian multinational companies, and other in the offing quest setting with Chinese multinational corporation. This was the result of the project development model agreement, which was the basis for negotiating with these projects, now accounting for more than 2,000 megawatts of electricity. Similarly, involving more than $3 billion of investment. So it is a country of tremendous possibilities, and you take advantage of this possibility. It is time to revive the old spirit of the 90s with greater vigor. We started a phase in the 90s that gave some result, but again, stunted. Now it is time to reinvigorate, rekindle, and create a new renaissance of industrial investment in Nepal to bring the country, to push the country in the new path of higher growth, social justice, and welfare.